Hi everybody, and welcome back to Twilight Princess HD. In the last episode, we discovered that we had a way to restore Ilia's memory, and that was to retrace her steps from where she lost her memory back in Castletown, and we found this thing, this wooden statue, this carving. And hopefully, by showing this to Ilia now, she will remember something else. Also, in the last episode, we found out that Shad is in the basement of the Kakariko Sanctuary, and he's researching an owl statue down there, but we can't do anything with him just yet. While these two side quests are intertwined with one another, they don't really depend on each other that much, I don't think. I think the two of them could have been done individually, but no, for some reason they've tied Ilia's memory to this whole sky beings research quest. I don't understand why. While I'm here, before I proceed on with the story, at the end of this episode I'm going to be showing off a bit of footage from a different game. However, it is relevant to Twilight Princess. I'm going to be showing off Link's crossbow training, as you might have guessed from the title of this video. But Link's crossbow training was a spin-off on the Wii, but it used loads of Twilight Princess assets. So I figured I'd show that off at the end of this episode. I wanted to show off at least at one point during this playthrough, and I figured why not make it at the end of this one. Anyway, let's not dawdle any longer and show Ilia the statue we picked up in the last episode that the doctor stole from her. What is this? I remember something. I was confined somewhere. Yes, and I was saved by whoever was confined with me. And when the person set me free, they gave me this statue. Yes, yes, I remember that much, but that means that person is still in trouble. Oh, what is wrong with me? I can't remember where that place was. I remember! Wait, what? Why do you remember? You weren't there. I thought I had seen that before somewhere. That belonged to the tribe that protected the Hylian royal family long ago. They worked in secret, so they lived in a lonely, forgotten place. But I heard the tribe dwindled in the prolonged wars. If you want to find that hidden village, look for a path leading to the Laneri province on the far side of the Bridge of Eldin. But a rock slide blocked the way to the village long ago, so you can't get there anymore. What? Oh, I do not mean to worry you, little human. Problems like these are not problems to Gorons. And that's the sound of the door slamming shut. I think Darbus just broke the door frame. Our patriarch Darbus will be waiting for you up ahead. Look at your map to see where. I will try to find the path beyond the Bridge of Eldin that leads to the near. Yes, you just said that. I don't know why you're whispering to me. I mean, you can pretty much tell everyone else in the room where this hidden village is. So, if we have a look at our map, we can see that the hidden village is, as he said, on the path to the Laneri province, just north of the Bridge of Eldin. So let's just warp over there. In fact, I'll do a quick cut. So, from the Bridge of Eldin, it's just a bit of a trek. There's no real convenient way of getting to this, aside from this Bridge of Eldin. Also, pay attention, you might see some certain things that will come in handy later on. That looks familiar. Also, I'm getting arrows from this goblin. When they're embedded in the ground, I think you can pick them up again. Once they stop burning, after all. Epona, I need Epona really to travel fast. There's horse grass over here, good. It's a random place for like a hidden village up in the path leading to the Laneri province. I did point it out a couple of episodes ago, but there was a path blocked by a rock slide. So if you recall that, that is our next destination. And Darbus somehow has made it here ahead of time, even though we have the ability to warp and we can go on horseback. I guess Darbus has like some kind of really fast rolling technique compared to other Gorons. Either that or it's just his size increase in speed. And sorry, opponent, I'm going to abandon you here so you get shot at by fire arrows while I take this little detour off to the side. I'm getting Minish Cap flashbacks. Luckily this rock slide doesn't require six Gorons. There is a hidden village up ahead, little human. The elders call it a forgotten place. The scent that has been burning my nostrils, it is the scent of evil. There is one powerful creature I have seen about, but under that beast are many minions who attack and plunder like a pack of hyenas. Do hyenas thrive in Hyrule? That doesn't make a lot of sense. There are 30, no, at most 20 of them ahead. They are probably just a small band of survivors, ragged remnants, who have settled leaderless into this village. If that is all there is, little human, then you alone are more than enough for them. But you have to defeat them all to save that girl's benefactor. Before you go, I will tell you the secret to besting them. Destroy them all before they spot you. Got a little human? So yeah, Darbus does have a rolling technique, but he seems pretty slow, to be honest. I don't know how he beat us to this location. And made a head start on the rock slide. Anyway, welcome to the Hidden Village, or Kakariko Village. This is the previous Kakariko Village. That doesn't make an awful lot of sense. Before you talk about, like, the Zelda timeline and stuff, and then everything just comes together in the end. But, yeah, this has been overtaken by Bulblins. Darbus was referring to King Bulblin back there, if you're wondering. He's their leader. But these are just some kind of stragglers who have made camp in the Hidden Village, and here we have a fun little part of the game where we go and track down 20 of these Bulblins. Now, Darbus said that we shouldn't be spotted to do things efficiently, but it doesn't really matter, we can just run in. I might use my Hawkeye just because, well, I don't know why not. We might as well. Haven't used it in a while and we don't often get a chance to do so. So make sure that I don't run out of arrows though. Okay, let's have a quick gander around. I see there's one there. I could probably shoot the explosive barrels next to them. That is another way of doing things. One off in the distance, that's one just below him. I can see movement. I cannot strafe while having the Hawkeye on, so that's a little bit of a downside. Yeah, I saw you. I saw a little bit of movement. There's one there. There's one far at the back in front of that doorway. Now, there's also one inside the buildings. Oh, there's several inside the buildings. I don't think there's any in here. Yeah, I already cleared this building out. I shot the one on the staircase through the window. Okay, now I need to be careful. There is one on the far ledge over there. He has seen me. Can he shoot through the doorway? I don't think so. This has got some... Okay, never mind, he can shoot through the doorway, apparently. But yeah, this is a rather iconic section to the game as well. So iconic that they used the music for this little showdown. Very nice Western-style music. When I say Western, I mean like Wild West, not from America. City, shush. But yeah, this is a very iconic tune. And they used it in Smash Brothers. I seem to keep referring to Smash Brothers. It's because it's a series that I know quite well. Okay, this is like a bar area. I see you on the upper ledge over there. Ouch. Should poke my head out. Those fire arrows are doing one heart at a time. There is also one... I can't really remember the angle I need to get to shoot at him, but he's in the ceiling. Yeah, I see you up there. He's on the roof of this building. Sorry, he's not in the ceiling. Like, hanging out. Can I, like, shoot you right in the kneecap? Yep, that worked. Okay, cool. Back here, there is a broken window, and in this little open area, there is a cuckoo and a howling stone. But we cannot transform... Oh, we can transform into a wolf. Can I howl out? Oh, I can. But I don't think you want to. I think if you use the howling stone, it resets the enemy counter, so I'm going to come back and do the howling stone after we're done with this little enemy hunt. Okay, now if I recall correctly... There's a back alley back here, and there should be at least one. In fact, let me go all in. Doesn't really matter if we're spotted or not. Darbus is speaking nonsense. We can handle them in head-on combat. Whoa! Why did that smash the window but didn't kill him in the process? I don't know. Weird. Okay, I see you over there, and there's one on the upper balcony as well that I missed, apparently. Oh! I think I clanged off that guy's arrow with my own arrow. Excuse me. Yeah, you can, like, knock the enemy arrows out of the way with your own arrows. Also, I think you can swipe them with your sword. Let's see on the watchtower up there. Die! Die, die, die! And he's dead. Okay, two remaining. There's another little back alley here. Nope, he's not there. So I'm gonna have to check inside another building. The other building is just over here. Ah, there's one. See you. I think the last one should be walking around inside here. Yep, there he is. And we're done. Or I would be if I didn't miss that. But there we go. all of the Bulblins dealt with. You can come out now. Oh, the howls of the beasts, they faded into silence. Squeeze between those explosive barrels there. Wait, are you... the Savior! It's you, the Savior! Please, please forgive me for not opening up the door. My name is Impas. I'm the last resident of this poor village. My name comes from the Great One who built this village so long ago. This village was once the secret home of a proud tribe who served the royal family. But it fell into decline and became infested with dangerous beasts. It's become an awful place. Excuse me for asking, but is your name Jack? Ah, I knew it. So then you saved that nice girl. How lovely. When she was here, she would often cheer me up by saying that she would come to help. That sweet girl, she worried about this old woman, even as I helped her to escape from here. By royal order, I can't leave this place until a certain person arrives, no matter what terrible fate is visited upon it. Oh, but listen to me, Blatheron. I have a favor to ask. Would you help me return this to her? I think she always kept it close to her heart, but even so, she didn't hesitate to part with it in order to protect me. And it's Ilia's charm, a charm that we have never seen before. Charming. This is the key to getting Ilia's memory back. So when we're next in Kakariko Village, I mean the real Kakariko Village, or the modern Kakariko Village, we'll be sure to show that to her. I believe in my heart that it's kept me safe all this time. So please, I ask that you return it to that girl. And we will do that, although that is very precarious, right next to these explosive barrels. Impas, you wanna step away for a second while I blow these up? Just to clear them out of the area. Sorry, I've just given you third-degree burns on your face by the looks of things, exploding them in too close proximity. But while we are here, we have something that we can do, and that is the Dominion Rod. I thought I could still swing it around, even though it's rusted. I thought you could still like hold it above your head. Maybe that's just a Wii version thing. But anyway, we can also show it to Impas.
Hey, that rod! Is that the Dominion Rod? Ah, could it really be? Are you the messenger to the heavens? Among the legends of my clan, there is a story from the time when the Uka still maintained contact with the royal family. Yes, it is said that a mysterious rod was handed down from the people of the sky, and it was called the Dominion Rod. The rod was only to be carried by the messenger to the heavens when the royal family needed to communicate with the Uka. From generation to generation, my ancestors have guarded the book that, by royal decree, was to be given to the messenger to the heavens. This is that book. Please take it.
And we get the ancient skybook. Said something there about missing characters, but this hint finding the path to the sky. So that's something we have to show to Shad.
This book is written in the ancient language of skywriting. I'm so glad I stayed in this village. If I had not met that young girl, what would have become of me? Meeting that girl must have been ordained by the gods, so that I could be here today to pass on this knowledge.
Yes, so now we have two important items to return to Kakariko Village. We have Ilia's charm, and we have the Book of... what's it called again? The Book of the Sky, or something? Info? Ancient Skybook, that's what it's called. Okay, good to know. So, let's head back to Kakariko Village. We cannot transform now that Impas is around, so we have to leave the village and then enter it back again. But there is some more stuff to do in this hidden village. This hidden village of old Kakariko. And if, of course, you're not aware, Impas is of course a reference to Impa from Ocarina of Time, Skyward Sword, Breath of the Wild. She's a recurring character, and Impas is named after her. For some reason, she's got a Z on the end of her name. I don't know if it's Impas or Impath, like the Spanish pronunciation of a Z. Impath. So I did come back here. Can I transform now? Yeah, okay, I can transform now that I've left the village and come back. And let's head back here. Wait, there's the window. There it is. Okay, so all the barrels are still around. But there is something else we can do in this hidden village. But we can't do it yet until we return Ilya's charm to her. So I've probably jumped the gun a bit here. The stuff hidden around is all monster loot. If you want some of that nice loot, just dig around to your heart's content. Okay, so, several dig patches. But no, that's not what we're here for. We're here for this Howling Stone. Middle, down, middle, up, down. Up, middle, up, middle. Middle, down. Middle, up, down. Up, middle, up, middle. Got it! One try! That's the most complicated one. So this should be quite a familiar tune if you've been keeping in touch with the series up to this point, and you'll see why in just a second when we howl out the actual melody. Once again, another original composition for Twilight Princess, and this is just happens to be the main thing. Doesn't sound a lot like it when you're howling it like this, but believe me, it is. Let teachings of old pass to you. Take sword in hand and find me for the final time. That is our last Howling Stone, and hence our last hidden skill that we'll get from it. Our seventh and final hidden skill. Anyway, the Golden Wolf now appears outside Hyrule Castle, so we have to... When we're next in Castle Town, I might go and visit that. Anyway, let's walk back to Kakariko and give Ilia's charm back to her. However, we're not done in the Hidden Village for this episode just yet. And we'll be coming back very shortly, because there is a little tiny mini-game that we can play. Also, sorry if these episodes have been a bit sort of long in terms of dialogue, rather than any actual exploring. But yeah, this is a very wordy side quest. Well, it's not even a side quest, it's the main story quest. But yeah, there's just a bunch of character dialogue that can't really be skipped through. And there's a bunch of context that would be missed otherwise. Anyway, Ilia's charm. Let's show it to her and spark her final memory. I knew you once. Yes, this feels so familiar. The scent of hay. Long ago, when we were young, you and I. You were always there. You were always beside me. This gift was meant for you. It was something I wanted to give you before you left on your journey. Please, Jack, take it. You got the horse call. Ilia made this just for Epona. And now we can summon Epona whenever we want. You don't need to worry about me any longer. Whenever you return, I'll be waiting for you. Jack, do you remember what I was saying about the Rod of the Heavens? Well, actually, it was about the Messenger of the Heavens who held the Rod. The nice woman who saved me told me about it. Apparently in this woman's village they've guarded something for the Heavenly Messenger for generations, so they await him. But they can't give this item away until the Messenger arrives with the Rod. That's why the lady couldn't leave her village, you see. Say, Jack, do you have any idea who this Messenger to the Heavens might be? Or even what the Rod is?
Well, we've already done that. We've already shown Impaz the Rod. And we got the ancient skybook, so now we can go and show Shad. But I'm not going to do that until the next episode, because that sparks the whole next step of the quest to reach the sky, and that is going to be the main purpose of the next episode. But we've restored Ilia's memory, and we have the horse call now. So let me... once again, we need to go back to the hidden village, and I'll go and do that little mini-game I was talking about. Also, I think there's a Poe there as well. But I don't know when the Poe appears, so we'll see when we get there. Might have jumped the gun a little bit on that as well. So, with the horse call, we can hit the Y button, or we can assign the horse call to any button and use it. Or, if you pause the game and tap it on the item screen, you can then press the ZL button to like instantly blow it, without having it equipped at all. So if I attach the Dominion Rod to the Y button, then tap the horse call, then hit ZL, I'll just use the item. Have to be paused to do that though, same with combining bomb arrows. For some reason just have to pause the game. Epona, are you coming? It's very far away apparently. Okay, let's get back to Thin Village. So, even though I said that the two quests aren't linked to... Excuse me, do you want to actually ride rather than getting off? The two quests for the sky and Ilia's memory aren't actually linked. You do have to do Ilia's memory first in order to get to Thin Village. I don't see why they couldn't let you do Ilia's memory quest in your own time, like way before this point, and then save the whole Dominion Rod thing until, you know, it's actually relevant, or destroying the Dominion Rod and reaching the sky. Save that until after the sixth dungeon. Ah, apparently you're useless. Just getting in the way. And let's roll. Or sprint to the Hidden Village. I am in a bit of a rush. I'm on a bit of a timer today. I've only got another... don't know how long I've got, really. Another 5 minutes? Hopefully this episode doesn't seem too rushed. And unfortunately this next mini-game coming up, it can be a bit time-consuming if you're not too attentive. But now when we next revisit the Hidden Village, it is now inhabited by a bunch of cats. Impaz is apparently a crazy cat lady. Do something fun with us, ask the cuckoo leader about it. And we know where the cuckoo leader is. He is in this building. Let me jive through the window, I just said. Let's dance! And let's talk to the cuckoo leader, or elder, or whatever he's called. Ah, welcome, this is the Forgotten Village! 30. No, more like 20. That's how many cats have made it back here to the village. So perhaps you could, you know, just play with them? Yep, okay, let's do this little minigame. Oh, thanks so much, they're so lonely. Perhaps you could talk to every one of them. But if you leave the village, it'll be like you never talked to any of them. Do you understand? Cats are forgetful. Oh, and let me give you a tip for speaking to all of them. Start at one end. Got it? Okay. Sorry about that little cut right there. As I said, I didn't have much time to record, but I'm back on a different day. You think you're ready to try that thing I was telling you about? Yes, that's because I got interrupted halfway through. These cuts are just so lonely, I really appreciate it. Seriously. Just don't disappear before you're done, okay? Yeah, I know. I'm a fool. Yes, I know, start one end. Got it. Bacock! Yep, I understand. But yes, I got interrupted, as I was expecting to happen. So, there's probably going to be some kind of weird cut there, unfortunately. So, this little... I can't really remember what I was talking about before, but, I can't really remember if I was talking about anything important before, but... Here we go, this is just sort of like a parody of the Shoot All the Bulblins little quest we had before. This time instead of 20 Bulblins, there are 20 cats that we need to talk to. And they'll give us their tally as we speak to them, but there's no like on-screen tally right now. And what is your neck doing? Just twisting it off. It goes around in a circle there. So, there are 20 of them, and I can't recall where all of them are, so it's just going to be a case of just wandering around until I discover all of them. I'm probably going to take the central alleyway first. Okay, that's something
rather annoying, is when you approach them, even if you've already talked to them, they will run up to you, and you can talk to them again, and they'll say that you've already talked to me. So the fact that they walk up to you is extremely, extremely annoying, because that means just you just lose count so much easier. And any other this way? Yep, there's one just sat here. Don't think there's any in the little yard where the cuckoo is, the cuckoo leader. That's the eighth one. And have I already talked to you? Yes, I have. Then please leave me alone. Don't walk up to me. Okay. I'm sure there's some in the back alleys. So let me go and check those out. Have I talked to you? Yes, I have. Okay. Yep. Just making sure. Got to be some back here. Now there's one back here. Is there any more? Incorrect. Okay, just one back there. Have I talked to you? You ran up to me. I don't recognise your colouring, but yes, I have already talked to you. God damn it. Okay, cat up there. Please don't jump down. Please stay up there so I actually know where you are. Can I get through the window, please? Thank you. Didn't do the dive for some reason. And there's another one. That's the 10th. We're halfway there. And I'm sure there's one in this side passage. I'm sure there is. Oh, there you are. You were behind me all along. It's the 11th. And have I talked to you? There's two in here with a similar colour. No, I haven't already talked to you. Okay. Interesting. Now we need to get up top. If you so need to get around to the balconies quicker, you can use this mesh that's hanging off the ledges. And, well, I mean, I think if you could hold on, that'd be much appreciated. Thank you. Yes, grab on. And there's another cat here, but we can't talk to them when we're regular Link. Otherwise we just pick them up, I think. Actually, that might be a good method to of doing things, is to pick them up as human Link. And then shove them in a location where they can't interrupt you, but that might be a bit tedious, honestly. And now we're on the upper balconies, and I know there's one here. I saw you from ground level. Nothing over that way. There's some on the other side balconies. Wolflink, please jump across. Unless I can't jump across as Wolflink, because his body's just too long to stand on this thing. Yeah, you can just hop across. And there's another one. It's the 15th. Five more to go. Some in here. Good. Yep, and I'm sure you're not the only one in this building. Any down here? Oh, never mind. Huh. We have an empty building. Never mind. Okay, now I'm getting a little bit lost. There's still water pool, there's none in there. Have I talked to you? Oh no, I haven't. Okay, one that I missed right down the central alley. That's interesting. That can happen quite frequently, apparently. Now, let's have a look up on this ledge, and up here is where the Poe's gonna be. But I think you have to play this minigame at least once before the Poe appears. However, no cats on this side. None on that little, on this little awning thing. Okay, that's the 18th, yep. Okay, back here, there's gotta be one back here. Never mind then. Oh, I can... Okay, this is like a tricky jump. You have to, like, go at an angle, I think, anyway. I can't really think of any other way of getting up there. There's no, like, claw shot target inside, is there? That I'm missing. Okay, there's definitely one on the upper ledge. Oh, there's one hidden behind the bloody barrels. That's annoying. So now the last one remaining is on the upper ledge. So do I have to do that really awkward, like, side jump to break through the window? Is that what it expects of me? I can't really think of any other method of getting in there. I don't think I've got any... Maybe I should just use regular Link. That's... What? Link, grab on! What's going on? Am I, like, gripping onto it too low and he's just not getting a grip on it? Can't pull myself up there. Okay, this time let me break the window in advance so that Wolflink can just clear straight through it. Actually, can I, like, grapple the... Oh no, shame. I was wondering if I could, like, grapple the cat and pull it towards me. That's just cruel. I can't do that. And from here, yeah, there we go. I guess just break the window in advance, rather than try and smash straight through it. And there is the final cat, and let's go and talk to the cuckoo leader for our reward. You talk to all of them! Thanks! Now your prize is in front of the old lady's house. Make sure you pick it up before you leave. What, you can't give it to me yourself? Or something? Okay. Little minor fetch quest here at the end of it all. Instead of the cuckoo leader just giving it to us, I guess he sort of hid it and then uncovered it, and yeah, it's a heart piece. Just set outside the front of Impaz's house. Impaz's... Is that the right pronunciation? I don't know. Anyway, that's the final thing in the Hidden Village, aside from the Poe. But yeah, that's the final major thing. And the Poe, is he there? Or do I have to leave the area? Oh, he is there, okay. So I guess you do have to just play with the cats in order to make him appear. Also make sure it's nighttime, obviously. And let's get back up to the ledge. Have to use regular link to grapple on. I don't know if you can hop straight across from this balcony to that one. Yeah, I don't think that's possible. Excuse me, Mr. Pussycat. What's new? Let's head on over here and... get him, boys! Get him! Sick him! Sick him! No? You're just too attached to me. Okay, can't attack the Poe with cats. But we can attack him, obviously, with Wolf Link. Knock him down. And this is a bit of a narrow battlefield. And we've got some observers watching us get that last Poe soul. But that's everything now. In the Hidden Village, we can leave this area and never come back. Or unless you want to like play with the cats again. I don't think you get a reward at all. But in the next episode, we're going to be heading back to Kakariko Village. And Midna, why do you have your arms crossed? You look very proud of yourself there for some reason. Yes, we've cleared everything. But yeah, in the next episode, we will head back to Kakariko Village and talk to Shad with our new ancient skybook. However, I did say that I'm going to show off Link's crossbow training at the end of this episode, and I'm going to hold my promise and show off a little bit of footage from that game. So let's jump on over. That's some pretty epic music for what is essentially a glorified shooting gallery. So this is Link's crossbow training, and as I mentioned early on in the episode, it is a Zelda spin-off. It was released in 2007, which is 1 year after Twilight Princess came out, and it uses a whole lot of Twilight Princess assets. In fact, it is set in the Hyrule of Twilight Princess. Some of the locations in the game are the same. There are some scenarios in Twilight Princess that reappear here in Link's crossbow training. And from this main menu, we get three options. I won't be able to show off the multiplayer, unfortunately. But I'm going to jump into Score Attack, first of all, and show off one whole level. Score Attack is the game's main mode, and I do have a save file on here. And there are 9 levels. I'm not going to show off every single level. I'm just going to touch upon level 1. So you notice little emblems underneath each level. That's my rank on each of them. Bronze, silver, gold. And then there is a platinum, but on this save file, on my Wii U, on the Wii channel on this Wii U, I don't have any platinums. I'm sure I have on my original Wii, but yeah, I haven't transferred any of my save files, so this is just what I've done quite recently, just to prepare myself for a little bit of footage. So, each level is split into 3 stages, and there are several different types of stage. We're starting off with regular target practice, and that's the general way each level will go. Start off with target practice. This one is in Auden Village, and this is just pretty much showing the basics of the game. The targets pop up, and we can shoot them, and our main objective is to shoot a bunch of them in a row to build up a combo multiplier. And this is its reward for like accuracy. You can't like start shooting wildly if you want to get a good score. You need to actually be aiming at things. Now, you might have noticed that I shot the signpost and also the head off the scarecrow. That doesn't count towards missing a shot. If you just flat out miss anything, like I'm shooting these pots now, and my combo is still going on. But yeah, if you miss anything, if you just shoot off into the distance and don't hit anything else, then you'll lose your combo just like that, and it's gone. And here's where I start sucking at the game. Oh, I triggered something there, but I didn't get a chance to show off. It was an orange rupee in that one pot, but I'll be able to show it off a bit later in a different level.
And if you shoot cuckoos, that deducts 100 points from your score. Just like many Zelda games, there is a negative impact to shooting cuckoos. The Wii Zapper was essentially just a big frame to hold the Wiimote and nunchuck in a way that made it look like a gun. And it also had a trigger underneath for the B button, which pressed when pressed inwards would press the B button on the actual Wiimote itself. So yeah, that's the main button in this game, is just the B button. But there's one other button that's used, and I think that's the Z button, which is used for zooming in. A bit like the Hawkeye, just like an instant Hawkeye in the main game. And here we have the second type of stage. This is a defender stage, in which many enemies will start patrolling towards you. In this particular defender stage, it's a circular arena, and you just rotate around 360 degrees. And for some reason, I'm just building up one single combo on this stealth boss, which isn't the worst thing in the world, I don't think. The defender stages are probably my least favourite, and they're also, well, that's because they're the hardest, I think. And that's because we've got a bunch of moving enemies, and it's really hard to maintain a combo when all these enemies are stumbling towards you. Also, I think it's like the circular nature of where all the enemies are around you, and you have to pay attention to your radar. Oh, right there, there's a green glowing enemy. And if you kill them, it gives you automatic fire for a brief period of time. And it allows you to just rapid fire and mow down the swarms of whatever enemies are coming towards you. So in the first stage, I got a piece of the Triforce at the end. That is your reward in the target practice stages for hitting every single target. And with the defender stages, you can get a Triforce piece as well. You have to defeat a certain number of enemies. I did not get that. Oh, there's the orange rupee again. The orange rupee sort of goes up and down after coming out of the pot, and the quicker you shoot it, the more points you get, and it eventually, after a little while, it will fade away. I think you can get up to 1,000 points if you just shoot it straight away as soon as it appears, which is quite tricky, honestly. So yeah, this is the third type of stage. This is, I guess they call it the Ranger type stage, and this one we have full control of Link. I say full control, but I'm like zooming in wildly there, just trying to get used to this zoom function. And with the Ranger type stages, you can also get a piece of the Triforce at the end. And I think with the target practice stages and the defender type stages, it gives you a solid 5,000 points every time you clear that objective. But in the Ranger stages, you get a different number of points. You have to defeat all the enemies in the area in a certain number of time. This is the Bulblin camp in Gerudo Desert, as you can see, and there are 25 Bulblins to defeat. And if you defeat all 25, you'll get 500 points per second that you have left on the clock. Unfortunately, I don't get to show this off in this Ranger stage because I missed an enemy back here. And I get really confused here because the radar keeps going off. And that's because the Bulblin's on the other side of the wall and I just completely blanked him. And let me just get a little bit more of the combo there. And that's my score from the previous run, or not the previous run, but my best score in total. And you get a different rank depending on how many points you get. 20,000 is bronze, 40,000 silver, 60,000 gold, and platinum is 80,000. You have to get at least a bronze in the previous level before you can move on to the next one. Like, you need to get a bronze in level 3 before you can move on to level 4, at least a bronze. And the one level that I struggled on most was probably level 7, which has got a terrible defender round, which unfortunately I won't be able to show off in this video because it's a location we haven't visited yet. Anyway, onto the practice menu, and this is just, you can take the stages individually, but you don't get like ranked overall. And I'll show off a few of these individual ones, but probably just briefly skim over them. So level 2, the first target practice in level 2, is slightly different than the one in Ordin Village. This one is you shooting Gorons with targets on their chest, and it also introduces the blue cross targets, which if you shoot them, it deducts 100 points from your score, I think it is. Also, something I didn't point out is that you get rewarded with more points if you shoot the center of the target than if you shot the outer ring. So yeah, that's also a reward for accuracy. And most of these stages are just mostly a minute long, 60 seconds. Some of them are a bit longer, and most of the time, at least with the target practice stages, it gives you 20 seconds per little set of targets,
as we saw in Olden Village, it's sort of the camera shifts across the map. The defender stages aren't just defeat all the enemies around you in a circle with a radar. This type of defender stage has you on a track, or you're in the boat from Isa's river rapid ride. In fact, this entire location is from that. And we're shooting toad pollies on the way down river, and they can shoot projectiles at you, and you can deflect them with your own arrows. But that's pretty much the whole defending yourself part of it. It's one of these, I think it's 6-2 when we're on horseback, and it's the carriage escort mission where we escort Ilia to Kakariko village. But yeah, because of all these moving targets, getting up a combo in these defender stages is not the easiest thing in the world. Also, if you take damage at any point, you'll also lose your combo. And that's why I don't really enjoy the defender stages that much at all. During the actual levels, where we're doing three stages in a row, they're probably the most annoying stages to get a bunch of points on, and the defender stage is probably where it's going to let your score down in the long run. And with the target practice stages, we're not just shooting targets, there are some slightly different ones. Most of the time it will just be regular targets, but in case of this one here, level 2, stage 3, we're shooting skulls. It's sort of like a clay pigeon shooting game, where someone's tossing skulls into the air and you just shoot them before they hit the ground. And level 3, stage 2, yeah, we are shooting fruit balloons, or plums fruit balloons, above Hyrule Castle at night. Somehow, firework fruit balloons, I don't know how that works. And we get more points if we shoot the smaller balloons. Also, for some reason there are meteors that you can shoot as well. Don't really know where they came from, I haven't seen them in the main game. Most of the time, the target practice stages are the first stage of each level. With level 3, that's just the same as level 1's target practice, but in Kakariko Village instead of Orden Village. With level 4's target practice, we're shooting the targets as they go down the waterfalls in Zora's domain. I don't think I can show off level 5's because it's a location we haven't visited yet. Level 6, we go back to Orden, but this time the camera is like panning around in a big circle rather than zooming to each location. Level 7's target range is kind of interesting. Seems to be half target practice stage and half defender stage, because during the last phase, the last 20 seconds, you have to fend off a bunch of re-dead knights, which is pretty much my worst nightmare in this game. And despite the fact there are so many of them, I do struggle to get a combo up here. I don't know why. But yeah, this is terrifying. Get them out of here. Level 8's target range is riding on horseback through Hyrule Field and shooting at targets. I suck at this because, as we learnt during the actual main game of Twilight Princess, I cannot aim while moving, apparently. I'm very terrible at that sort of thing. I think the Ranger stages are probably my favourite, in which you have full control over Link, and they also take you through some quite well-designed areas. You've only got a certain number of time to actually go and shoot every enemy, so they have to sort of compress each area down. But yeah, they're quite fun stages. Level 6 Ranger stage is based on Snowpeak Mansion, and you're going around shooting Chilfoss. Level 7 Ranger is the Temple of Time, and we're shooting the Zelfoss. Level 4 is based on the Farron Woods, and we're going around shooting Sculptulas. And yeah, they're just quite original stages. Level 5 in particular is relevant to this video, and I might save that for the end. Level 5 Stage 3 is another Ranger stage, but I'm going to hold off on that one. Now, probably the most interesting Ranger stage, well, at least I count it as a Ranger stage, is level 8's stage 3. Now, it's actually a boss battle. I still count it as a Ranger stage because we have full control of Link, and the controls are exactly the same as the other Ranger stages. But it's the Darknut Duel from the Temple of Time. And I did make an allusion to this in the actual episode where we fought the Darknut. Where this Darknut in particular, for some strange reason, is surrounded by a swarm of insects, and most of his attacks are insect-based. For some weird reason, I don't understand why. And what's weirder is that his entire body seems to be made of insects. Shoot him a bunch of times, he splits apart and into a swarm of insects, and you need to shoot the white ones to like do the most damage to him. Also, when bits of his armor break off, they become like these giant black insects that you need to shoot away, because they'll just constantly fly towards you. Oh yeah, one thing I forgot to mention in previous stages, because I didn't really realise it until quite late into recording. But you can hold down the B button to charge up a bomb arrow. And I think that's most useful in the boss stages and ranger stages. But yeah, just so you know, you have a charge attack pretty much in this game. Something that I almost completely forgot about. And I have mentioned that I don't really like the Defender stages, but the final Ranger stage is based on the Skull Kid boss fight, and it's actually pretty cool, because you have to shoot Skull Kid when he's glowing green in order to get the Rapid Fire Crossbow. Rapid Fire Crossbow? How does that work? We have the technology, apparently. But yeah, this stage is pretty fun, I find, and it's quite easy to get a good score on it, because it's Skull Kid himself that delivers the Rapid Fire upon you. If you just find him and shoot him. It's quite interesting. But there's one more stage I want to show off aside from level 5's ranger stage, and that is the very final level, final stage. And that is a final boss, in fact. And I mentioned it at the time, but it is Svelod again. I don't know why they chose to use Svelod as a boss, but it works. He's fought in a very different way than he was in Twilight Princess. Rather than using Spinner Track, he's got targets on both of his hands and on the back of his head. With the boss stages, they function the same as the Ranger stages in that the more time that's left on the clock at the end, you get a times 500 multiplier to it, and that gets added to your score. And that's pretty much where the bulk of your score is going to come from in the two boss stages, Darknut and Stalord. He's got targets on both of his hands, which you need to shoot away, and once destroying both of his hands, he'll collapse onto the ground and allow you to shoot the target, which is on top of his head. And in between phases, he gradually gets faster and faster and starts crawling towards you, and if he like strikes you with one of his hands, then that's minus 100 points. And between phases, he shoots like flaming rocks out of his mouth, and sometimes fire bubbles during the later phases anyway. Oh, also something of note. I don't know why, but they used the GameCube version of the assets, like non-mirrored version. That's going to be a bit confusing if you only have a Wii and you've brought the Wii version of Twilight Princess and Link's Frostbow Training, because the two versions' locations are still mirrored. Link's Crossbow Training is not mirrored, but Twilight Princess on the Wii was mirrored. So yeah, that's going to be a little confusing if you've only got a Wii in playing these two games. But yeah, that's just something a bit weird that I noticed. Anyway, to top off this little mini trip into Link's Crossbow Training, I thought I'd just show it off because, you know, it's related to Twilight Princess. I'm going to show off Stage 3 from Level 5, Kakariko Shootout, and yeah, it's the Hidden Village, called Kakariko Village, officially in Link's Crossbow Training. Only in the PAL version, I think, anyway. Some of the levels are titled differently in the North American version. But yeah, here is going around shooting Bulblins in Ranger mode. This one was pretty fun to get a high score on, because in this time there are 25 Bulblins around the place, and also you have a strict time limit, which we didn't have in the original Twilight Princess. But I'm going to leave you with this one, and I will see you in the next episode back in Twilight Princess HD, where we will go and talk to Shad and progress the story, and we're on our way to the 7th dungeon. So, I will see you then. Bye for now.